My name is Mark Goldberg, and I am the interim director of adult basic skills at Clackamas Community College, and have the opportunity to collaborate with colleagues from the National Skills Coalition to set up this webinar focused on digital inclusion. And just a little bit of framing before we get started. The Council for Adult Basic Skills Development, so the adult education directors, have really been focused on this issue of digital inclusion for a while, and recognizing students in college foundations programs, ESOL, GED, adult high school diploma, have some challenges, and did so even before COVID in terms of the digital literacy skills, access to technology, and broadband. And then that really has been exacerbated exponentially during COVID as we've shifted to remote or virtual instruction. So it's a topic we've discussed as a group and really wanted to amplify the issue and bring in some experts on the policy side, really use this as a jumping off point. And it was perfect to reach out to National Skills Coalition because Oregon is part of the SkillSpan network, which is 20 states together that are focusing on advocacy and policy for skill strategies leading to economic mobility, closing opportunity gaps for students. And that really is our Pathways to Opportunity work in Oregon. So we have invited in the Pathways to Opportunity Broad Coalition to participate, as well as the STEP Group and the Oregon Pathways Alliance, the Career Pathways Groups. We also recognize this is not an issue just for adult education students, that these are issues for all students in all different programs across our 17 community colleges. So it's a topic that's pertinent to all of us, and just appreciate National Skills Coalition partnering with us. Just a few brief things. So this is being recorded. We will send this out afterwards for folks that may not be able to join us live. We also, in the registration, solicited questions that you have tied to policy related to digital inclusion. So I know Amanda and Devin from NSC will do their best to answer questions, but there are going to be some questions that we're not able to get to, they're not able to get to, and we hope that the Adult Basic Skills Directors, the STEP Group, PTO, and Career Pathways Groups will continue to discuss this really important issue beyond this webinar. As far as the webinar itself and the agenda, I will introduce Amanda and Devin shortly. Amanda will give an overview of this topic of digital inclusion. Devin will speak to the SkillSpan network and connections there, and really a call to action for all of us. Kate Kinder is going to offer a little bit as it ties into Pathways to Opportunity policy work, as we're working on a bill in the legislature that includes digital inclusion. Then we'll just have a facilitated conversation I'll get to have with Amanda and Devin based on the questions that you submitted with some overarching themes. Then we will open it up for Q&A through the chat box, so live Q&A, and then we will wrap up. So that's the agenda. What I'd like to do now is introduce Amanda Berkson-Shilcock and Devin Miner from NSC. So Amanda is a senior fellow at National Skills Coalition, where she leads the organization's work on adult education and workforce policies to expand opportunities for US-born and immigrant adults. Throughout her career, Amanda's worked with state and federal policymakers and skills advocates to develop policy solutions that address the challenges facing adult learners and job seekers, including immigrant workers. Amanda's based in my hometown of Philadelphia and also Washington, DC. So welcome, Amanda. And then secondly, Devin Miner is a state network manager with National Skills Coalition. Devin supports the development and promotion of a network of state coalitions working to advance policies that support industry engagement, skills equity, public accountability, and job-driven investments in collaboration with NSC staff, national partners, and local coalition leads. Devin collaborates with his colleagues at NSC to provide customized technical assistance to state coalitions, particularly Western states, including Oregon, towards policy impacts. Devin joined NSC in 2019 and is based in Los Angeles, California, and Washington, DC. So welcome, Devin and Amanda. And from here, I will pass it off to Amanda.
Great. Thanks so much, Mark. It's a real pleasure to be here with all of you today. Thanks to Mark and Kate for helping us organize this. And of course, my colleague, Devin, who leads our work in Oregon. So I'm about to run through a bunch of information here. I just want to emphasize something that Mark already said, which is you're going to get these slides afterward and you're going to get a recording afterward. So no need to kind of scramble and try to take notes or remember particular statistics or numbers I'm going to share, because you'll have all of that to refer back to after today's conversation. I would also encourage you to go ahead and drop messages, questions into the Q&A box as they occur to you. We probably won't be addressing them in the presentation part, but we'll certainly get to them in the Q&A. And so you should feel free to go ahead and do that whenever a question occurs to you. So just moving along here. So we talk about the term digital inclusion in the title of today's event. And I wanted to just briefly talk about how that's being defined, and then share a little bit of in the way of examples, what policymakers have done over the last year, in particular since COVID hit, to really tackle digital inclusion needs, share some data about what we know about US workers' digital skill gaps, share some examples of how other adult educators in other parts of the country are tackling this issue, and then give you some sort of action items for how you can advocate for effective public policies. I know that folks also have a lot of questions about the practice side of digital inclusion work. Program models, curricula, device issues, Wi-Fi, broadband issues, they are really important questions. They are not part of my policy-oriented presentation today, but there are some really great organizations that are close partners of ours, like the National Digital Inclusion Alliance and World Education's Ed Tech Center. And I have included two full slides of resources at the end of today's presentation that you'll be able to follow up with if you want to delve deeper on those kinds of questions. I just wanted to include that here because I know a lot of you had submitted questions in advance that touched on these topics, and I didn't want you to think that we were ignoring them. Okay, so you've met Devin and me, but a little bit about National Skills Coalition as an organization. We're a 20-year-old nonprofit. We were founded as a big tent bipartisan coalition that brings together a really broad array of stakeholders who support education and workforce development, particularly to help folks access good jobs that require skills training, typically more than a high school diploma, but not a four-year degree. We have four networks that are part of our sort of coalition. We have our national network of about 20,000 members across the country, workforce boards, adult education providers, community colleges, labor unions, labor management partnerships, chambers of commerce, industry associations, really anyone you can think of who kind of touches on the issues of workforce training. We have our SkillSpan State Policy Advocacy Network. Oregon is one of our key members of that network, and you'll hear a little bit later from both Devin and Kate about the Pathways to Opportunity piece of the puzzle and how Oregon fits into that work and indeed is leading some of that work. We have a Business Leaders United affiliate, which focuses on small and mid-sized businesses investing in worker training. And then we have the worker level grassroots network Voices for Skills. So what do we mean when we say digital inclusion? Folks often talk about three legs of the stool when it comes to digital inclusion. The first is access. Do people have broadband internet at home? The second, digital devices, right? Are people trying to do everything from a smartphone? Do they have a tablet? Do they have a laptop? Do they have a Chromebook for their child's school that might be locked down and doesn't let the parent access everything? And then the final piece is skills. Can people have the digital literacy skills they need to use different types of software, download apps, install them, you know, confidently navigate through all the different digital tools that we need in order to do our jobs and indeed to engage in the world more broadly. Since COVID hit, I like to sort of refer to what folks have been doing as kind of the COVID scramble, right? There have been a lot of quick response adaptations that people have had to make. oh my goodness, we have to get everybody, you know, quick emergency devices. We have to figure out Wi-Fi. My instructors themselves are having broadband issues at home. And there have been a lot of really ingenious short-term solutions developed, but we're now almost a year into the pandemic. So part of my goal today is to help us move from that kind of rapid response, short-term thinking into some of the longer-term policy advocacy that we need to do to make sure that your programs have the resources you need to actually be able to support your learners, support your instructors, and support your communities. We see also that policymakers have been scrambling. In April of 2020, several federal agencies began to put out some updated guidance on how TANF, which is Temporary Assistance for Needy Families, SNAP ENT, which is the employment and training arm of the food stamps program, and the Workforce Innovation Opportunity Act could in some cases be used in limited ways for digital inclusion. Now, if you had any encounters with this, you may have realized this was kind of a double-edged sword, right? It wasn't any new money in those systems to help with that. It was just a clarification of what those systems could cover. And in some cases, that was pretty limited, right? Some folks have been going back and forth. Can we only cover loaner devices for people? Or could we buy somebody a computer that they can keep? You know, can we only get them Wi-Fi hotspots? Or could we maybe get them, you know, ongoing internet broadband at home? That's, you know, those are all particular challenges that have come up. And then, of course, in December, Congress passed another COVID relief piece of legislation, which has $285 million, which will be going to minority-serving higher education institutions, that is, tribal colleges and universities, Hispanic-serving institutions, and historically Black colleges and universities, to support a whole range of activities, but that does include digital inclusion. And the feds have a webinar coming up next month with more details about those grants. So I know you'll be getting information about that from your higher ed partners in Oregon. States themselves have also taken action. California has contracted with a company called CellEd to provide a mobile learning app and devices for adult learners who are TANF or SNAP recipients. Michigan is using some federal money to create a digital inclusion pilot program for refugees. New York has used some funding to create what they call the Immigrants Can Code pilot program, which is an IT training program for entry-level work for immigrants. And all of the services that folks have kind of hustled to provide are really good and important, but longer-term durable policies that can provide sustained resources to your institutions and to your programs are really crucial to making sure that people don't just keep having to do these kind of short-term scrambles. So let's talk about what that means, right? When we say it's time to level up, right? In 2020, folks were just doing everything they could to keep the lights on and be able to serve their learners and be able to run their programs. But in 2021, we really have an opportunity to connect the dots for policymakers. Some policymakers understood digital issues before the pandemic, but for a lot of them, it took the pandemic for them to have an aha moment and to realize, wow, if I care about telehealth for my constituents, if I care about my constituents being able to support their K-12 students at home, if I care about workforce, if I care about small business success, all of these things tie to digital inclusion. And we've started to see adult education and higher ed advocates around the country connect the dots for policymakers and say, okay, you've realized this is really important for your constituents. Now let us talk to you about why we as educators are really well positioned to help people build these skills if you invest enough resources in us that we're able to do that, right? So how do we do that? The first thing is using data. And I'll just tell you something very frankly that I've heard from a number of folks in Congress as well as in other policymaking roles, which is they say, there's a lot of big dramatic information out there about technology, but there's not very much in the way of specifics, right? So you have big consulting firms like Deloitte or McKinsey that release these reports that say robots are coming and people's jobs are getting automated and everyone's job is a technology job these days. They don't really know what that looks like. So having data to talk about what are employers' digital skills, what are workers' digital skills, and how do we help workers build the skills they need to get good jobs is really important. And being able to share a specific story that you may have heard from one of your students or your learners, right? Well, before the pandemic, I had a job as a medical receptionist. Now I have to be able to stand in the parking lot of a medical clinic with an iPad 6 feet away from our patients and walk them through how to do, you know, patient registration on an iPad in the parking lot. Or, you know, my job used to be to code for medical billing. Now we're using artificial intelligence software that does the first pass at the coding, and I have to be the human pair of eyes that looks at it after that to see what kind of mistakes the software made, right? Did they somehow schedule a 9-month-old baby for a mammogram, right? Or something like that. So being able to share those really detailed examples that you may have heard from your students and learners about, I work retail, we never really used mobile apps, but since the pandemic, everybody's doing curbside pickup. Now we need to know how to use mobile apps. Those can help policymakers understand why your programs need greater investment. So what does it mean to share data, right? We did research last year showing that nearly a third of workers, that's currently employed people ages 16 to 64, lack digital skills. And many of those folks have a high school education or less. So they're the kind of people who are very often walking in the door of a community college or an adult education program. A lot of folks think, okay, well, this is about older workers. They're going to retire from the workforce and it won't be a problem. First of all, that's not fair to a lot of older workers who are actually great at technology. But second of all, it's not accurate in the sense that a lot of younger workers do still have digital skill gaps. You can see on this chart, the green bars are people ages 16 to 24 or 25 to 34, and a quite significant percentage of people with no digital skills on the left-hand side or limited digital skills on the right-hand side fall into one of those two age groups, right? A lot of people under 35 still lack digital skills. We see that people with digital skill gaps are racially and ethnically diverse. Again, on the left-hand side, we're looking at people with no digital skills. On the right-hand side, we're looking at people with limited digital skills. In both cases, while workers of color are overrepresented, overall, white workers are the plurality of people with digital skill gaps. We also know that a lot of these workers are employed in jobs that require them to use computers. Right? So even workers with no digital skills, 38% of them say that moderate or complex computer skills are needed for their current job. And it's even a little higher among workers with limited skills. So we did some qualitative interviewing to kind of figure out what this means in real life. And the short answer is people spend an exhausting amount of time covering for and compensating for their skill gaps. They take things home to work on at night, which means they usually get a child or a spouse to help them. They get coworkers to cover for them. They draw on their supervisors for help walking through. So this is a productivity hit, a revenue hit for employers, but it's kind of hidden, right? We also found that a fifth of workers with no digital skills are supervising other people, and a third of workers with limited skills are supervising other people. So when they have limited skills themselves, they become a productivity bottleneck for their colleagues. So that's data, right? I just gave you a bunch of charts and graphs. If you find that sort of stuff compelling, you're welcome to sort of copy paste and use any of those charts in your own presentations. Just put a little credit saying source National Skills Coalition and you're good to go. But you know, connecting that data to the models that we know work is really important. And you might be thinking right now, gosh, Amanda, we are trying to keep our heads above water here. We are trying to make sure that folks are getting access to the programs and services they need. What are you talking about? We haven't had time to be developing new models. The good news is I've done a lot of research over the last 8 months, talking to people all over the country about what are the best practices in teaching digital skills. And my guess is these are very aligned with some of the career pathways work and related work that you've been doing. So what does it look like? Partnerships between educational institutions and employers, right? You might be thinking, oh yeah, we do that, right? On the non-credit side of the house, we have customized training. On the, you know, adult ed side of the house, we know that a lot of our students and learners are employed in big local industries in our area. We often hear from them about what they have to do on the job, right? Contextualized and integrated learning, right? Integrated education and training is something that adult educators have been working on for several years now, right? That's not new. We just know now that it's just as true for digital skills as it is for anything else, right? If you want a construction worker to learn digital skills, you probably don't want to plunk them in front of a computer and try to get them to learn Microsoft Office. Instead, you want them to be learning the mobile apps that general contractors are going to need them to use when they're out on site on a building job, right? Rapid prototyping. You may be sitting there going, I've never heard that phrase before, or hey, I thought that was a tech industry phrase. It is a tech industry phrase, but we have stolen it for the adult education field, and I am proud of us for doing that, because rapid prototyping is exactly what you all already do, right? You make a design for a program, you start implementing it, you see how it's working out, and then you tinker with it a little bit. You say, okay, well, it didn't quite work to be doing it this way. Let's try to adjust a little bit and do it that way, right? That is rapid prototyping. And that is a best practice in building digital literacy skills, right? So you may not have been doing it for digital skills, but I'm sure you've been doing it for other kinds of skills. So I've given you a bunch of data. I've talked to you about some of the emerging models we know are really effective. I've talked about how adult educators in other parts of the country are sort of connecting the dots for policymakers to say, hey, if this is the thing you care about, then you really need to invest in adult education and higher education to help your constituents get these skills and to help your businesses in your communities get workers with these skills. Now I'm going to hand it over to my colleague, Devin, who's going to talk about the organizing and advocacy piece of how you add your voice to others to be able to really bring these discussions up to a level where policymakers can hear you. So Devin, over to you.
Thank you, Amanda. And thank you to Mark and Kate for having us today. My colleague Amanda just touched on this a bit earlier, but I want to dive a little deeper about some of NSC's work. So at NSC, we advance our mission by engaging our broad-based coalition of over 28,000 members across the nation and organizing advocacy and communications to advance both state and federal policies. These policies are usually based on the ground expertise, like many of you on today's webinar. As Amanda kind of touched on earlier, our broad-based coalition represents a diverse set of stakeholders, full of community colleges, adult education providers, community-based organizations, nonprofit training providers, labor, businesses, and local boards, all of whom can work together to push and advance for a common agenda on issues such as digital inclusion. At NSC, we recognize that no one organization can do the important work and elusive work alone, and that there's strength in numbers. So in knowing that, while NSC has a reach of over across all 50 states, we have worked over the years to formalize partnerships with 20 states through our SkillSpan initiative. And you all can see the 20 states highlighted on your highlighted in green on your screen for the 20 states that we work in. And our SkillSpan network is the first ever nationwide network of nonpartisan state coalitions expanding skills training for thousands of people through state policy change. Here in Oregon, as mentioned earlier, we collaborate with the Portland Community College and their Pathways to Opportunity Initiative to develop and promote skills policies that support adult learners' career aspirations, boost local businesses, and help states build strong, inclusive economies. You all now have the opportunity to better align yourself with some of the work of our Skillsman leads here in Oregon today. As you heard from my colleague Amanda earlier today, she has equipped you with some data. She has pointed to some best practices. And now you all have the opportunity to couple those tools with your on the ground expertise to better organize and advocate for policies that promote digital inclusion. Next slide, please. As I mentioned earlier, you know, there are strength in numbers. Everyone's voice on today's webinar is important, and I want to pass it over to Mark and Kate to share an opportunity that you all can take in the immediate future to advocate for effective digital inclusion policies.
Thank you, Devin, very much, and thanks, Amanda, for hosting this great webinar. So I just wanted to make the connection between our Pathways to Opportunity work and our advocacy there, and then how we can connect this into digital inclusion, and really how that we can, as a group, make system change and policy change, excuse me, when we work with partners and with each other. So for those of you who aren't familiar with Pathways to Opportunity, we are a statewide coalition. So it's that all 17 community colleges, our partners at Oregon Department of Human Services, community-based organizations, like Partners for Hungry for Oregon, Oregon Food Bank, and then a Higher Education Coordinating Commission, OCCA. So it's a really inclusive process and group of looking at how we can advance opportunity in our state and close opportunity gaps. And so really focused on what that can look like right now during COVID. So we know that there are huge impacts on all of the states. We also know that that is not equitable across communities and individuals. So we are looking at pathways to opportunity is how can we change programs? How can we change program policy to advance racial equity, to increase economic mobility, and to also increase rural opportunity? So those are really the three focus areas, and digital inclusion is very key in that, and making sure that at a program level that we can serve students, that we can create opportunities in the way that we need to. So just as an example of how this has made a difference and is making a difference, we have a bill that is being is in the current legislative session. It is House Bill 2835, and that would put a benefits navigator at every public community college and university in the state. And so this bill came out of a collective process. So we worked with Partners for Hungry for Oregon. It incorporated all the feedback from all of the colleges, guidance from National Skills Coalition, Oregon Department of Human Services have been really integral from the beginning. And so having this benefits navigator would help ensure that all students had access to the benefits and resources they needed. The Oregon Department of Human Services has been a key partner and would train those benefits navigators. And so, in addition to getting connected to benefits like SNAP and enrollment in the STEP program, there is also the potential to really thoughtfully connect in broadband resources there and digital literacy. And how do we make sure that folks are getting connected to the holistic set of services that they need? And so I think that's just an example of how we actually can cause change and put forth suggestions and policy, and how the policies that we make have a very direct impact on the day-to-day work that we do with our students, whether that's in the classroom, whether that's overseeing a program, providing holistic coaching. And so just wanted to provide encouragement that there is that opportunity to weigh in on that bill. And then going forward, we will integrate digital inclusion as a theme and a strategy that we need to and can address through our STEP consortia and through our Pathways to Opportunity work. So just kind of connecting the dots, how this all fits in and how we can carry this forward to talk about policy and to talk about the pragmatic day-to-day curricular and program level details.
Thank you, Kate, for tying it to the House Bill 2835 and our broad PTO work. And I would just add as well that there are institutional and state policies and initiatives in place where we can also point to shifts that would support digital inclusion. So no, on the adult education side, we have a federal Title II grant. How can we maximize those resources to support digital inclusion? I know institutions across our 17 colleges are working on how to create better access for students with devices and so on. So there's a lot of work that we can control within our own institutions and really think about an inclusive approach in addition to pushing on state and federal policies. So with that, we're going to transition to some of the themes that were apparent in the questions that folks submitted before the webinar, and we'll look to Amanda and Devin as our experts here. And so we'll start with a question or theme for Amanda, and that really is focused on how adult educators can design programs and services to really help learners build their digital skills.
Thanks, Mark. So, you know, this came up over and over again in the questions that many of you submitted for today's webinar. You wanted to know what your peers in other parts of the country are doing. So I'm going to share several different examples. They vary quite a bit. So if you hear one that just doesn't seem like a fit, don't worry, I'll be sharing others. So the first example comes at the kind of low end of the spectrum for students and workers who have really limited digital skills experience. Maybe they own a smartphone, maybe they share a smartphone with other family members. They may have very limited experience using a mouse, for example, or highlighting text on screen, right? And the national nonprofit International Rescue Committee has 25 nonprofit affiliates around the country that provide education and workforce services, including adult education type services, to low-income immigrants, refugees, and also US-born folks. And IRC has been very pragmatic in kind of designing some on-ramps for students and workers, tying it as much as they can to everyday life, right? If you've been in the adult education world for a long enough time, you know the phrase realia, right? Back in the day, when we brought realia into the classroom, it was a bus schedule or something else from students' real lives that we would use to help them connect the dots between the information they were learning and how they'd actually apply that information in real life. Erica Borey at IRC is based at their national office in San Diego, but she's been leading some really creative work in very entry-level foundational digital skills for adult learners. Happy to put folks in touch with her directly if that's something you're working on and you'd like to chat about more. At the other end of the spectrum, at Kauai Community College in Hawaii, which is a tribal college and university, they are doing some really innovative work around IT positions. They did enough research with the US Military Pacific Central Command, which is a major employer in that part of the world, about what kind of credentials were needed for folks in entry-level IT jobs and how to make sure that community college students were getting prepared with those skills. So they do now CompTIA certifications and others. They've done some apprenticeship work so that people can do work-based learning and acquire digital skills while they're getting paid, which, as you know, for a lot of adult learners, it can be really hard to take time off from work to focus on schooling. So an earn while you learn or apprenticeship model is really powerful in actually enabling people to keep supporting their families while they're learning more skills. Another example that we've heard about is coming from Pima Community College down in Arizona in Tucson. And they are doing some simulation training, right? So for folks in industries where you can't physically go in person right now to work inside an ambulance and train to be an EMT, or to work in a manufacturing facility and train with some of the technological equipment you need to do in advanced manufacturing, they've been doing some 360 degree recordings, right? So that it feels like you're almost wearing immersive goggles to look at the space in which you would ordinarily be working as, say, an EMT. They're very much in learning mode, and they'd be the first to say they haven't figured it all out, but they are thinking about that both on the non-credit side and on the credit bearing side. And Pima has a pretty robust integrated education and training set of adult education sort of on-ramps. So they're definitely thinking about how digital skills fit in that. And then the last piece I'll mention is just reiterating something I said before, which is almost everybody I've talked to says, we can't teach digital literacy in isolation. It has to be part of something that students already want to learn and have already chosen to learn, whether that is a biology class, whether that is a phlebotomy class, whether that is a, you know, CNC operator training program, whatever it is, we need to have digital literacy well integrated into that. And that means two things. It means we have to talk to our employer partners enough that we know what skills they really need. And we have to make sure our instructors have the professional development they need to actually be able to meaningfully assist students. Because it's not helpful for students if the instructors themselves don't have a good enough grounding in what they're gonna need to be doing. So that's something I've heard over and over again from community college and adult education leaders all over the country. I did see, by the way, that there was an earlier question submitted about the difference between digital skills and digital literacy. If that person could elaborate on their question a little bit in the Q&A box, when we get to the live portion of the Q&A, I'd be happy to try to tackle that, but it would help to have a little more specificity of what you're asking. Back to you, Mark.
Well, thanks, Amanda, and appreciate you pointing to other community technical colleges that we can all look to and learn from. And I think another aspect of this overarching topic is really the costs, and curious how other states and localities are paying for digital inclusion programs and services.
Yeah, great question. So there are a few major pools of funding and then some other sort of fill in the gaps, right? So some of them are definitely doing this as part of Pell funded or traditional financial aid funded credit bearing higher education, right? And the reason they're doing it is, again, not as a standalone class, but they're realizing, okay, if we're teaching folks in allied health professional roles, they need to be able to use electronic health records, right? They needed that even before the pandemic, but they really need it now. So let's incorporate that into that program, and then we can get paid for teaching it because the student is paying for that program using Pell, using other types of financial aid that they have traditionally used. So that's one piece of the puzzle. States are also using CARES Act funding, right? So CARES Act money came from Congress in the spring of 2020. It went to states and localities. It went to higher education institutions. It was originally supposed to be spent by December 30th, 2020. Congress has now extended the deadline so that money can be spent as late as December 31st, 2021. So if you felt like maybe you already got turned down from somebody that you tried to get CARES Act money from, this might be a moment to go back to them and say, hey, we're still here. And that money, if it's not spent yet, could be allocated to support us. And then we've also seen there is some flexibility and some willingness at the federal level to be a little more creative, right? So we've seen that the federal SNAP employment and training program analysts, for example, are really trying to figure out what folks on the ground in SNAP ENT programs need and how they might try to be as flexible as they can within the confines of their program. I've done two briefings for regional SNAP ENT providers in the past couple of months, and I know the feds are working hard on that and are very interested in hearing feedback from the field about what kind of flexibility would be most useful. We're also seeing some states are using TANF money, both to provide loaner digital devices in some cases and to actually pay for digital skills training in some cases. Some states are using WIOA ITA money, individual training account funds, to support training provided by eligible training providers, which of course many community colleges are. On digital skills. And then, to be honest, some states and localities are using little bits of flexible money. So a little bit of a corporate donation, a little bit of a private foundation donation to do a quick kind of proof of concept program. We're going to do this for 10 students. We're going to show you how it works. And then we're going to try to get state legislature or our governor's attention about why this needs to be a broader scale investment. So there's a bunch of different ways that folks are trying to crack the nut of paying for this. But in most cases, it's much more powerful to pay for this when you are weaving it into education or workforce investments rather than trying to do it as a standalone, no, you're just paying for the technology piece. I've seen much more success in the former than I have in the latter. The latter only really seems to work if you're trying to go after a quick grant from a Google or a Microsoft or another tech company where they're very into the idea of just the technology piece. Back to you, Mark.
Great, thanks, Amanda. So next theme and question is really for Devin and thinking about collaboration and organizing within digital inclusion issues and wondering if you could talk about who some key partners are that adult educators could work with to really partner and support organization and advocacy.
Sure, thanks, Mark. So I think the most important partner here is the students and workers themselves, right? They are the experts. They know what their day-to-day opportunities and barriers are. And so it's important to figure out how we can collaborate with those on the ground experts to essentially elevate what they're experiencing and make sure that policymakers and decision makers are hearing them, right? And so really making sure that we empower the voices of the folks who are most impacted by the policies and decisions that are happening both at the state and federal level. I saw in the chat someone kind of like emphasize the need to make sure that, you know, that we are make sure that we are addressing the students and the learners holistically, right? And so I think building on that, it's important to also build these relationships with community-based organizations, nonprofit chain providers, local boards, labor, businesses, to really kind of elevate all of the essential needs that, students and workers are having. So to the extent that we can have a unified voice, to the extent that we have a more unified voice, the better it will be as far as making sure that we have policies that essentially benefit the folks who are at the local level. So making sure that we are locking arms with these different folks because they are likely having the same call to action. They are likely experiencing the same types of issues as it relates to digital inclusion. And so it's important to like build those partnerships and relationships. The last kind of player that I want to elevate is state agencies. So to the extent possible, identifying an opportunity to work with someone in the state agency. I think once you have that relationship with someone in state agencies, the more likely you are able to kind of elevate the best practices that are happening on the ground. State agencies are likely to have funds that you can tap into to better uplift the work that you're doing, and then to also make sure that that folks who are in decision-making spaces see the work that's happening on the ground. So really making sure when possible to develop those relationships with state agencies. And so I know that we all work with different players, and I know that other folks will elevate different players, but I think, you know, the ones I just elevate as far as student workers, students and workers, community-based organizations, nonprofit chain providers, local boards, et cetera, state agencies, I think those are critical players to the puzzle. And so I'll pass it back over to you.
Appreciate that comprehensive response, Devin. And not to put anyone on the spot here, it is a webinar, but I will say that I recognize we have some state partners on the webinar, some folks from Department of Human Services, as well as the State Higher Education Coordinating Commission, Adult Basic Skills team. So just appreciate that partnership and look forward to continued dialogue. And then I think back to where you started with really students and workers. I mean, that's a key theme of our Pathways to Opportunity work too, is how do we elevate our students' voices and really ensure that any policies that we're pushing on were really driven by students and their experiences, really anchoring there. And then lastly, with the community-based organizations and the question is recognizing digital literacy skills can't be taught ideally in isolation, as Amanda said, but then recognizing the holistic aspects of the student and really collaborating with community-based organizations that may have other expertise so we can really support students comprehensively. So appreciate that response, Devin. And I think we'll go back to Amanda again. And as you had started with the three-legged stool and want to come back to where adult educators can turn to get technical advice on the broadband side, as well as the digital device access for our students.
Yeah, so I'm going to reel through a bunch of resources here. And again, no need to scribble fast and take notes. You will have all of these in the slides that you're getting after today's webinar. So you'll have the links to the websites I'm going to mention it and things like that. So the first is the National Digital Inclusion Alliance. This is a five-year-old organization, but the folks who are members of it have often been in the field for several decades. And they have about 500 state and local affiliates around the everything from housing authorities to public libraries to community colleges, who are all working on some aspect of the digital inclusion work. They have folks on their listserv, which is free to subscribe to, and I encourage you to subscribe to it, who can answer everything from how do we pressure Comcast or Verizon to provide better, you know, high-speed access in their low-income program to how do I help my student get a refurbished computer? I live in XYZ area of the country. So that's a really good source of expertise for the kind of nuts and bolts questions about, okay, we're trying to hand out Wi-Fi hotspots and we're running into this problem. Or, you know, hey, I'm an educator. I'm not really set up to provide tech support. How do you suggest that we approach this issue around the tech support that my students are struggling with so that they can even participate in their education, right? So NDIA's website is digitalinclusion.org. Again, they're in the resources linked to the slides. They have a digital navigator manual on their website. So it tells you how folks are training for this new position called digital navigator, which is kind of like tech support on steroids, basically. It's not somebody who's just there to tell you the answer. It's kind of a paraprofessional. For those of you who know anything about the public health model of prometoras, paraprofessionals who help people manage chronic diseases like diabetes, this is kind of like that, except for digital skills, right? It's paraprofessionals, people who are peers of the students and workers that they're helping, who can help folks to get the kind of nuts and bolts they need of, I'm trying to set up my Chromebook, or I'm trying to figure out how to use Zoom or Blackboard for my class, that kind of a thing. So they have a really handy training manual for digital navigators. And they have some other resources on their website about, you know, what does it mean to run a digital inclusion program? How do you know what your organization might want to take on versus what might be out of scope for you? Really useful, whether you're at a large institution or a small community-based nonprofit. The second resource is World Education's Ed Tech Center. And this is really practitioner and sort of professional development piece, right? Those of you who've been in adult ed for a while, you certainly know World Ed's many professional development webinars and courses. But their Ed Tech Center is specifically focused on these more thorny issues of what does it mean to provide high quality technical education for people? We had a wonderful, very sophisticated question in the chat today from one of your peers, Eric, who was asking about not just digital skills, but sort of critical thinking and information literacy and sort of bigger picture questions. And the World Ed Tech Center folks are often having discussions about those very issues. And what does it mean as an instructor? Are we just teaching people how to use the tool? Or are we teaching them to be critical about which apps they put on their phone and how those apps might potentially, you know, jeopardize their privacy or how they can have a greater sense of autonomy over the technology they might be interacting with. There's also an informal national group called the Open Door Collective. In one of the leaders in that is a gentleman named David Rosen, who many of you may know. David's been well respected for a long time in the adult education field. And David has done a lot of thinking about what he calls learning circles. It's not just David who calls them that, a lot of folks do, that are kind of peer opportunities for helping people develop, again, not just digital skills, but the kind of ability to think critically about the technological tools that they're engaging with. So David and the Open Door Collective are another good resource. On that front, it's an all-volunteer group. It's pretty bare bones, but a lot of really thoughtful people there. And then finally, you know, there's NDIA, there's the EdTech Center, there's the Open Door Collective of adult educators. But I think the other piece of the puzzle to keep in mind is you yourselves are experts. Not that you're experts about everything technology related. You are experts about how technology is affecting the work you're trying to do and the outcomes your students are trying to achieve. And even if you only have time in your day to maybe once every 3 months, you know, put a couple of paragraphs on LinkedIn or send a letter to the editor of your local newspaper, you are a storyteller to help decision makers in the media, in policy, understand the real life ways that these issues play out for people, right? We have all seen since this pandemic, the TV news stories where it's like, heartwarming story of a woman who drives her minivan to a parking lot at 5 a.m. so that her children can do school in the parking lot. Well, it is heartwarming on an individual level, but that is a horrific policy failure, right? And so when we think about ourselves as experts and as witnesses and collaborators with our students and our institutions, we think about how we can be storytellers that illuminate for people how an individual's experience is reflective of bigger structural things that we're all fighting against, right? And when you illuminate those things, that's when you can kind of start the pebble that starts the avalanche of policy change, right? What does it mean for these individual folks that they are running into this barrier, right? What does it mean for a higher education student when they have to give back the Chromebook at the end of the semester because it was only a loaner, but they were trying to do some ancillary credential building in the break over winter and they can't do that because they had to give back their loaner laptop, right? Illustrating that can be incredibly powerful in shifting the landscape in which policy conversations are happening. So I would remember to give yourselves credit as experts yourselves. Again, not that you have all the answers, but that you are close to the ground and having expertise of how these issues actually play out for people.
Thanks, Amanda. That's really helpful and inspiring in thinking about that pebble as it relates to policy and really the responsibility we all carry in how we see this work daily in our work and interactions with students. And I guess in the same regard, one last theme, and it's a big question and really the focus of this whole webinar is just policy changes. So wondering if Devin and or Amanda, either of you, want to speak any further on, you know, what kind of policy changes can adult educators here really advocate for in the digital inclusion realm?
Yeah, definitely. I could take a first take at it, and Amanda, if you want to fill in if I miss anything. But one, I just think Amanda did a great job of elevating the different ways in which we can advocate for policy change throughout her presentation. So I'll try to capture some of that. And then I'll also share some examples just based on work that we've done it in other states. And so you all in Oregon may be already doing some of this. And so I'll just list some of the things that, you know, you all can advocate for. So one is, you know, create a new or call for greater investment in any digital inclusion grants where funding is allocated to education, workforce providers, and other qualified organizations who have digital skills building programs that are culturally and linguistically inclusive, and equip learners with all three legs of the stool that Amanda highlighted at the beginning of her presentation. The second thing that folks can advocate for is making sure that there's an expansion in the use of existing adult education funds to support digital inclusion. The third is to make sure that digital inclusion is explicitly permitted in any existing pools of money. And then lastly is to make sure that we are better utilizing federal funds to support all legs of the stool. And so Amanda kind of touched on, you know, how we all can better leverage WIOA, the CARES Act, and TANF as examples. And so those are just the four things that I just want to like zero in on. And Amanda, if you have anything additional to add off, I welcome you to do so.
I think that was very comprehensive. Thanks, Devin.
So those were really the large themes that we gleaned from the questions that folks submitted before the webinar, and wanted to then open it up for more Q&A in the chat box and see we've still got some questions there. And so I think to start with, see, there's a question or two that really touches on the urgency right now, that this is a need that's imminent, and wondering if you have any thoughts, Amanda and Devin, on how we can really expedite this work as we consider all aspects of digital inclusion to support our students.
Yeah, I can take first stab, and then if Devin wants to chime in. So the first thing is I've seen two strategies work effectively. One is when you make Congress or policymakers feel the urgency. So in other words, it feels urgent to you every day because you're confronting the real life consequences of it. It doesn't yet feel fully urgent to policymakers, because depending on the position they're in, they are not getting the drumbeat of information about it, right? And so one thing to think about is, you know, if you have time as part of coalitions that you're part of through Pathways to Opportunity, to even just organize that drumbeat, right? If you can get one person to call an office every day for 2 weeks, you've created a drumbeat, right? And all you did was get 10 people to make, you know, one call a piece on one particular day of the week. But suddenly that office is feeling the drumbeat that you're feeling, right? The second thing is to look for mandates that people are already under the gun to accomplish, and then help them see why solving this issue is crucial to getting that mandate accomplished, right? So I'll give you a quick example from a different area, right? 43 states have set post-secondary attainment goals, right? You've often seen these as, you know, governor says 60% of Texas residents will have a post-secondary credential by the year 2030, that kind of a thing. Usually there's somebody within state government or, you know, within local government, depending on what the policy is, who's you know, feeling the pressure of that mandate, trying to get it accomplished. And where I've seen there be success in winning new resources is when people successfully connected the dots to say, for example, hey, you know, county so-and-so, you have this goal of 60% of adults getting to a post-secondary credential by this year. If we don't serve students of color effectively, we're not going to get there. So can you invest some resources in this proven model for closing racial equity gaps that my community organization has been working on, right? So again, connecting the dots either by making them feel the pain point and the urgency that you feel every day, or by helping them understand how investing in what you want to invest them in can help them get to a mandate that they already feel under some pressure from their boss, whoever their boss may be, to accomplish. Devin, anything you want to add to that point?
Yeah, a few things. So one, I think there's immediate action and opportunity right now that Kate presented. So that's another way in which we could quickly elevate the need, right? And that's something that we can leverage right now. Kate and her team has already done the work to kind of set up an opportunity for folks to let their voice be heard. So make sure that you all are in connection with Kate and Mark, and just be sure to follow up with them to figure out how you can support existing work and existing efforts that they are leading at the state level. And then to kind of like underscore what Amanda just shared, is building those partnerships. And it's going back to the point I made earlier. So the more, to the extent possible, the more that we can have a unified voice across different intersections, I think that's when policymakers will begin to sense the urgency, right? And so when folks from education, from workforce, you know, from different types of intersections all come together and say, hey, this is an issue that cuts across all issues and many issues, I think then policymakers will have a sense of fire to move and act quickly to make sure that, you know, digital inclusion is something that they prioritize.
So thank you, Devin and Amanda. See, there have been some questions that you've been able to answer in the chat box already, and there's still a few more. So I'm not sure if there's anything more you could add, I think, to Eric's questions about the distinction of digital skills and digital literacies, and I appreciate, Eric, that you shared that article as well. But wonder, Amanda and Devin, if there's anything more you'd want to touch on there?
I don't know that I'm the best position to add things on it. I'm just going to emphasize again that there are some really thoughtful people who are wrestling with exactly this. There is a fantastic monthly newsletter called, I think it's called Data and Labor. I'll look it up. I'll include it in the resources that we send out afterwards. But there are folks who are really wrestling with these issues. What are the ethics of teaching people just to kind of live with bad technology versus teaching people how to proactively navigate technology and not just live with it, but themselves kind of take hold of it and make it work to their purposes or challenge the ways in which it may be damaging to them and their communities. You know, those conversations are going on in a number of spaces now. The civic tech hashtag on Twitter, it's a lot of private tech, you know, sort of hacker folks who have gone into public service and government to build apps that better serve people. One example is the Get Cal Fresh app that was built for California. So it's the SNAP app. It helps people apply for food stamps in a very simple way using their mobile phone. And the folks who worked on that are really passionate about what does it mean for the end users of technology to feel a sense of autonomy and ownership over the technology that shapes their lives, whether they're applying for public benefits or using it on the job or some other context. So that's another kind of issue that folks are wrestling with. I see Eric also has a question in there about internet access and, you know, the Lifeline program and internet access as a utility. That's exactly the kind of stuff that gets discussed on the listserv of the National Digital Inclusion Alliance. There are groups like the Electronic Frontier Foundation, the Public Knowledge, Benton Institute, who work on this stuff every day. I'm not remotely qualified to try to give an intelligent answer on that question. So that's why I'm sort of diverting you there. And then the last piece I want to mention, because I had said this in written form in the chat, is folks had asked about the trauma-informed piece of instruction. The Heartland Alliance, which is a nonprofit based in the Midwest, has done some interesting work kind of challenging assumptions in the social services world and in education and workforce development, and trying to think about what would a trauma-informed lens for job training and education actually look like. So I would point to their work as a place to start in thinking about the trauma-informed lens in this area.
Great, thanks Amanda for responses on those questions. Just seeing what else we've got coming in here. question earlier, how can we borrow from the textual literacy teaching world to help develop our digital literacy teaching skills, from Davida?
Yeah, you know, there's a lot of practitioner questions like that. And I would say, you know, there's kind of three places where I see those conversations happening a lot. One, it's sporadic, but when it happens, it's nice. Is the links free online website from the US Department of Education, which will host discussion topics on various sort of subject areas. So that's certainly one where you could start a discussion topic and see what might get picked up. The second place where I see those discussions happening is in World Education's courses. And the folks there are really receptive to suggestions and ideas. So if you're not already in touch there and you'd like to be, feel free to email me offline and I can connect you there so that you can float that question with them. And then the third piece is groups like the National Coalition for Literacy. And if you're not part of their listserv, you know, they get a little less into the weeds of practitioner stuff, but they have a lot of amazing practitioners on the list. So if you just wanted to kind of post that question, my guess is you get some nice responses off list from how people are thinking about it. But I think that's as much as I can reasonably offer, because it's not my daily work now that I'm not in the practitioner world every day.
Appreciate those resources. They're really good ones. And links is connected to world.now too, right? So I don't see any new questions coming in. I think we've covered most of them, if not all. So we'll give folks another minute or two if you have questions before we wrap up. And just appreciate Amanda and Devin, both of you, taking time to share your insights and expertise and enormous resources that you have or are connected to with our colleagues here in Oregon.
We're so excited to be able to do it. And honestly, we're so appreciative of the thoughtfulness of the questions. It's a special thing to know how many people are out there working so diligently in such a scary, difficult time for so many people. And I just want to acknowledge, you know, there are many demands on you as humans, as citizens, as teachers, as people who care about equity and justice. And the fact that you're carving out some time to be part of this discussion today and to do this work more generally is really meaningful. And I just want to acknowledge that.
Well, thank you, Amanda. And I think we will wrap up here in the next few minutes. So first and foremost, just want to thank Amanda and Devin for taking time again to join us to facilitate this webinar and National Skills Coalition in doing so, and ongoing support to Oregon and our field here. Also just wanted to recognize and appreciate the state HEC Adult Basic Skills team for their collaboration with a group of adult education leaders. And know that this topic and this webinar is really a jumping off point for our group. We'll be meeting in a few weeks and we'll continue the dialogue on the topic of digital inclusion for the Council of Adult Basic Skills Directors. And then know that the PTO and the STEP groups, as well as the Career Pathways Alliance, will do the same, or hope that you will do the same. Thank you everyone for joining us, and we will send out the recording of this webinar as soon as we can. And the slides that Amanda and Devin had with the list of resources as well. Thank you very much. Anything, Amanda, Devin, that you'd want to say? Okay. Appreciate it, everyone. Take good care.
Thank you.